You can keep going, the slides will be up in just a minute.
I don't normally speak with slides, so the last time I tried speaking with slides, it was, I got very distracted by the slides. I kept moving up the slides, so yeah. I'll try not to do that, I'll just talk a little bit. I thought what I would do is, I guess first of all, have any of you heard of Redwood Park Communities? Getting the idea about it. And that came about because we kind of felt like we were living double lives. We, on one hand, were in our community here in Barrie, and we were working with some of the women and children that were leaving the women's shelter and who had fled domestic violence. And we weren't doing a lot with them. We were just kind of volunteering to help them move out of the shelter into their new housing. And on the other side, I was down in Toronto for work. I worked for one of the biggest builders in the province. I was their senior project manager, and we had all kinds of stuff going on in high rises and mid rises and golf courses and commercial developments. And there was a lot of money flowing around, and there was a lot of money being spent on things that didn't matter. And I was having a hard time bringing the two realities of those two worlds together. And I just started feeling a little bit unfulfilled in my life, like I needed to do something that had a little bit more meaning, a little bit more importance to it. And that's kind of where the idea of Redwood started to come from. So Redwood Park Communities was created to provide safe, local, affordable housing for some of our more vulnerable neighbors that we live with in the community. And we ended up starting our first project on Toronto Street in downtown Barrie. It was an old abandoned Victorian semi. It was boarded up and it was falling apart. It was actually being used as a drug den. And the police were constantly coming by to check on it. The fire department was coming by to check on it. And it was becoming a bit of an eyesore physically in the community. And when we first saw it, we thought, this is perfect. This is exactly the right spot. And we wanted to be able to take something and make it beautiful, and make it new, and make it hopeful again. And our vision with that was, on one hand, to see people's lives change in a way that they would move into something and feel, wow, you know, I can't believe I get the opportunity to live here. And it would change something in their mind. And what we thought and hoped that would be was actually hope. We wanted people to start being able to dream again, thinking again about their future and hope for what could be better. And that's kind of what ended up happening. And on the other hand, we kind of wanted it to have an impact in the neighborhood. We wanted to kind of have the opposite effect of that broken window syndrome, you know, where you have a neighbor whose window is broken and then it doesn't get fixed, and then, you know, the other neighbor has their condo and it doesn't get fixed, and then all of a sudden you have this breakdown. That's what they call the broken window syndrome. And we wanted to do the opposite. We wanted to repair the window, repair what was once an eyesore in the community, and encourage neighbors, not by going door to door saying, hey, do something with the place, but just doing something different and make people think, hey, I like what they did there, I'm going to try that on here. And it wasn't about keeping up with the Joneses, it was just about creating this atmosphere of a community that would come together and revitalize themselves and support each other. So that was kind of how things sort of got going. We had this brilliant idea that we would just come out into the community and tell everybody what our great idea was, and everybody would line up and write checks so we could get on to the races. That didn't work out. So what we decided to do was do something about it. And because of my construction background, and before that I was in the financial industry down in Toronto, and we were able to leverage construction money, which I didn't really want to do because it's really expensive and it could either break us So what we learned in the process accidentally, it wasn't intentional, what we learned in the process accidentally was that it wasn't about housing. We really thought that it was going to be about housing, and then we would come into the neighborhood and then save the neighborhood and, you know, build new housing, and that wasn't the case at all. I think my wife's life and my life and the lives of our children changed way more dramatically when we started to develop this sense of community and camaraderie with the families and the women and the children that we were working with. And we started learning so much more from them than what we were, you know, doing. And they're absolutely my heroes every day. When I hear their stories and hear what they've gone through in their life, and I'm always completely blown away. Because I know, for me, if that was me and that was my story, I probably wouldn't get by. I would have given up long, long ago. But every day, some of the families that we work with, they get up every day and they think, okay, today is going to be a better day. They can do this. And then they get dragged down and beat up, and you know, it's horrible. And then the next day they get up and they're saying the same thing. I can do this. This is going to be a better day. And what we discovered was that it was really hard for them to do that and to be successful when they're out there all on their own trying to do it. And what they really just needed was just knowing that somebody was there, somebody cared, somebody had their back, that they were supported, they were loved, they were cared about, they were brothers and sisters, moms and dads and grandparents, and that started to change everything for my own family and for the families of the people that we were working with. And that's kind of how things started to roll with Redwood. So we opened up this place on Toronto Street, and it was five little apartments. And we kind of thought, well, it's five apartments, it's not much, it'll be a drop in the bucket. But we opened in May of 2013 with these five little apartments, and so we put a bit of office space in there. And we've had, in that short period of time, 152 women and their children that have come through this transitional apartments. Just these five little apartments that have gone back to school, that have gotten jobs, that have finished nursing. Some of them are nurses that go to Pro Hospital or up in Aurelia now. Some are actually back to school and they're getting their teaching degrees. And before, they were hopeless. They were homeless, they had no place to go, and they were at a point in their life where they wanted to give up. And that was incredible. And the impact it had on the children, and seeing the impact on the children was incredible. It still is every day. Really incredible. So that was the first little 5 minutes we did. And that's when we realized that we needed to do more. We needed to keep going. And it was really just the beginning. This, well, let's do a little bit, and maybe something will happen. And now it's become a passion where, no, we need to do more. We need to encourage our communities to come together and do the same things, and do good things in their own communities this way, and to be part of being there for each other, and strengthening each other, and helping each other as they go through life. One of the things that we know from our own experience is during this whole process, it was really ironic, because when we were getting going, when we finally got these first 5 minutes open, my wife and I ended up being homeless ourselves because we had run out of money. We poured money and time in our own things. We used to have a pretty big custom home that I built off of the big Point Road, and we'd been living there, and we sold that, and we moved into a friend's house and lived in their basement with our four kids and two bedrooms. And we thought, well, we'll only be here for a couple of weeks, and we were there for almost 2 years. And then after that, we had another friend that said, it's super space. And they had a house. They were going to Finland, back to Finland for a year, and they offered up their place for us to stay and live there. And all of that in our own personal lives was going on while we were trying to get this idea of Redwood up and running. And so it became our story at the same time, not just somebody else's story. It became our story where we went through a rough time, and what we realized was that we were able children, and they've been out there just trying to survive on their own. And it's really hard to see sometimes when people will stand back and judge them for the decisions that they make, rather than being in awe of the weight and the burden of what they have to carry through life. And I'm always in awe of the weight and burden that they carry, and yet they often get up every day with the same attitude, like, I can do this, this can be a better day. And that's really inspiring for me. So that's kind of the little bit of preamble of how we got started. But now we've gotten to the point where, I don't know why I'm supposed to point this.
No, you don't have to point this.
I'll just push this question.
Yeah.
So,
just push it.
We now have, that's okay. That was just kind of what we
focus.
Provide affordable, hopeful state housing in partnership with other local agencies in town. One of the things that we wanted to do was, when we started, we didn't want to duplicate something that everybody else or other agencies were already doing. We wanted to look at what our own skill sets were and step in and help out in a way that was practical, that we could partner with the other agencies in that sense. And for me and for us, it did start with housing. It was an opportunity for us to use the skills that I had developed in my career to create housing, and we wanted to do it in partnership with other agencies. So the women's shelter, for example, what were their needs and what could we build to help support those needs. And the same thing with the Busby Center, and we'll get into that with the motel conversion. What can we do to help support the Busby and the families and the individuals that they're working with? And the same thing with the Salvation Army, the Bayside Mission, where we're going to be building, starting in the spring, another 12-unit building that's going to be a family housing and support center for families in crisis. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk about that too. But so that's one of the things that we wanted to do, is partner with other organizations to help support the great work that they were already doing. So we do have a team. There's myself and my wife, Rhonda, and Rhonda is our director of housing and family support. So what we've done with our housing that makes us a little bit different than any other housing provider or any social housing is we created this really strong volunteer family support team. So my wife just started getting paid for the first time since 2009 to do that job as that director, and she's got a good team of Aaron Hatton and Jean Peppin, who are her family support coordinators. Those are the only three paid staff. And we have a team of about 20 really well-trained volunteer family support workers that have been with us and have grown with us. And three of them are actually women that have come through our housing that are now coming back and volunteering to help them women that were in the same situation that they were in. And that's how we support our families. And they do all kinds of practical things. So the practical stuff that they do is if somebody wants to go back to school and they're having a really hard time because they're studying for exams for the other kids, then they'll babysit so that the mom or the dad, in some cases, can actually focus on their school and be successful there. Sometimes they're just having a bad day and you're talking and get all the bad stuff out. So we'll sit and have a coffee or a tea. We're meet together. And then we do fun things too. We'll do holiday things, so kind of like this. We'll do a Christmas dinner. I know on Thursday nights now, over at the place on Toronto Street, which we call United House, they do a fun show night. I think I forget what the latest show is that they're all into, but they all get together in a big community room that we have, and they'll watch a show together and have fun. And once a month, similar to this as well, they get together and have what they call house meetings, so they can all talk together and talk about what's working for them and what's not working. And just give them practical support that way. Rides to doctor's appointments, rides to legal appointments, rides to the grocery store, the food bank, whatever it is that they need. One of the things that we do with all of our units is whenever somebody moves in, they move in to a completely fresh set of sheets and towels and toiletries, and the cupboards and the kitchens are always full of food. And then we also provide a good food box to every single unit, every single month, so that they have fresh food and vegetables. And we have a couple churches in town that also do a food box, but it's not just any food box. They put it together specifically, and they include recipes with how to, or how to put those specific ingredients together to make healthy meals for the kids and for themselves. And so that's what happens in our units across the board. That's what our family support team does. We have a community development coordinator, Jennifer, and Bill, and I know you've been talking with Jennifer. She was going to be here tonight, but wasn't able to come. And we have a second suites coordinator. We'll get into our second suites in a minute. He works on working with homeowners who are interested in creating some affordable housing space within the old homes of property. So that's kind of our team. We have a board of directors, Nathan Barnes, who's the lead pastor at Box and Lines Church here in Barrie, and he's our chairman. And then he's really instrumental in the community aspect of Redwood. He's very, very big on the community, and he's very supportive of the family support team. Amanda Smith, who is our treasurer, and she is a CPA and works doing charity audits across the country. And Mark Mulder, who is one of our board members, he's newer to the team, and he's part of one of the board of plumbing here in town, and they employ quite a few people who do lots of work in the community and building industry, and he's on our board as well. And then we have a ton of support staff and volunteers. The core of our family support team are listed there. We've got a facilities manager who works part-time and volunteers the rest of his time to help keep up with the quality and maintenance of the units when there's issues. We have a lady, Ruth Ann Crank, who is the director, I guess, of human resources at Georgia College. She recently retired, and she's come on board to volunteer, helping out with human resources. Administrative assistant, Megan, marketing coordinator. Again, they're all volunteers who are volunteering their time to support what it is that we're doing. And then we regularly have Georgia College students out of their social services program that come in and co-ops with us. And we're often asked to go, because we do everything completely not by the book in terms of social services are concerned. So I guess we're called disturbers. I don't know, but they come and have us speak at Georgia College all the time and talk about how we do things and why we do things the way we do. And because of that, they keep sending their students to us because they want them to see how they can
think outside the box. Yeah, think outside the box.
That's right. So our mission at Redwood is to help build safe, local, affordable communities that support families and individuals. And our vision over the next 7 years is we want to see 6,000 individuals within our local community supported with the housing and we create a partnership with others. Our values, number one, is around community. We believe the opposite of homelessness is community, it's not housing. Fostering support of the community is the heart of who we are and what we do. Hope, we believe hope is life. We're committed to fostering hope and supporting individuals to live fulfilled lives. This is where I am looking at the slides because it's hard to remember all of these sometimes. Responsibility, we're committed to offering choice, supporting informed decisions, and promoting self-sufficiency. One of the things that we also hold very dearly is that responsibility aspect. One of the things that we have learned as we've gone along is that we should never really do something for somebody that they're capable of doing for themselves, but support them as they're doing it. And so that's something that's important to us. And dignity, we recognize that every individual has a value and purpose. We believe we all have a human right to a basic standard of life, privacy, and dignity, and that no one should ever have to sacrifice one of these rights for another. Housing First, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Housing First idea, but the idea behind Housing First is that everybody has a right to housing, everybody should be safely and affordably housed, and then regardless of their circumstances, and then wrap them in supports to help them be successful in maintaining their housing. Collaboration, we believe in working with others to help us realize our innovation. We believe in an innovative approach to family support, housing design, and community creation. We do think very much outside the box. We don't think within the lines. We're often accused of coloring outside the lines. But we want to think of creative ways to actually get more housing done. And an example of that is like the motel conversion, taking an older building like that. It was used very much for a similar purpose and actually making it sustainable, affordable housing that people can call home and be a beautiful spot. And I think that you guys are really going to like it when it's done, because it's not going to be an eyesore anymore. It's going to really look nice in the community. So our current work is United House, and I talked about that as the 5 units down on Toronto Street. After we did that, we really felt strongly that we wanted to engage more community and be involved in being a solution to affordable housing. We didn't feel that it was the government's job to solve some of these complex issues. We felt that it was had a lot more to do with the community's ability to solve these issues. And so one of the things we started with Redwood Second Suites, I know a couple of years ago, the city of Barrie didn't allow second suites. The province mandated that they would come up with a second suite policy, and they were dragging their heels. So we got involved in a survey and inserted ourselves in the conversation, which got us in some trouble. But from that, we ended up with a council who became very supportive of it. They passed some new bylaws around second suites. And city staff were totally on board, and we had to work through some issues there, but I think it's working much better now and much more smoothly. And so we started what we call our Redwood Second Suites program, and that is that we want to get out into the communities and encourage people that have extra space in their homes, whether it's unfinished basement or some attic space that can be used, or some space in a garage or a garden suite of some kind. Where what Redwood will do is we'll come in and assess your property and actually create the space for you. You as the homeowner, the property owner, benefit from that, so we're not doing it for free. You guys would actually pay for it, but we come in and we get it done. And one of the benefits about that is that we can apply and we have to have various government programs or different forms of funding and whatnot to try and help offset some of those costs for you. But a lot of people are interested in second suites, but they don't really know how to go about doing it, or they have to deal with contractors that don't show up. Anybody know anything about that? So we just come in and we get it done. And then what we'll do is we'll lease that property back from you to house families that are in need that we're working with. You don't have to be the landlord. You'll be our landlord, Redwood's landlord. So the first every single month, your rent that we agreed to is deposited directly into your bank account. You don't ever have to worry about whether or not the tenant's actually paying for rent or not. We take care of that. We support them. And what we found right now is we have 8 second suites that are up and operational. And with one exception, the property owners that are there on site that are living there have actually become part of support team because it's just worked out that way. And I think that's beautiful. Not that you have to do that if you're a chef, but it's just really remarkable how that happens. So I'm very grateful for that. We have 7 more suites that are currently under construction as well. So by, I would say within the next, by July or so, we'll have a total of 15 second suites that are up and running, and we're looking to do more. Because the more we can do, the more we'll contribute to solving affordable housing issues. So that's kind of a bit about our second suites. So as you may have second suites. And then the Motel Redwood project. So that's a project that Sarah Pettle from the Investment Center and I started talking about 3 years ago. Sarah came to me and said, you know that little motel out on Essa Road, can we do something with that? And yeah, well, yeah, we can. So we worked really hard together planning for it. Of course, the city liked it. Carl Gatt, who was the chief on Essa Road lately, but it's under construction, and it's going to be completed. We're expecting occupancies late January. We're hoping to get it done before the winter season, but we can't go there early, and we gotta go a bit delayed. So it didn't really work out. But there's gonna be 12 bachelor units in there, and they're gonna have full kitchens. Small kitchens, but full kitchens. And they're gonna have Murphy beds, but now they're gonna have day beds. And they're gonna have a little eating and breakfast area if you need that. And they have showers. So two of the units are accessible units. Amongst our population that are experiencing homelessness for accessible units, because some of them have some very severe physical issues that they're dealing with. We also have two units that are a little bit larger that are going to be for couples, because we also have some couples that are experiencing homelessness right now. And then the rest of the units are smaller and will be for individuals. There's still a house beside the hotel. This is just sort of a rendering of what it will look like-ish when it's done. It'll be a little bit nicer than that picture, actually. But there's going to be a little house next door, and you've probably seen that as well. And it's going to have five suites in it. They're not full apartments, they're just suites, and they're transitional. The units in the motel are more permanent or longer term, and the units in the house are transitional. And the other for second stage addiction. So often from Barrie, people that have gone away for addiction treatment, when they come back, they're back in the regular communities. And one of the things that we're missing in there that some of the other communities do have is a second stage. So after they come back, they can spend some programming time, a few weeks or a few months, within the second stage addiction center facility, so that when they come back out of that, they're in much better shape to stay successfully sober or drug free. There's going to be two community rooms, I don't know if you know, but on the front of the motel, which is L-shaped, there's a sort of story and a half looking section, and that used to be the motel office, and the manager of the motel used to live in there, and that is not going to be a big, huge, open space community room. There's an accessible bathroom in there, and a big kitchen that is going to be for doing social events, eating some meals together, cooking classes, those types of things. And then in the lower level of that space are some meeting rooms, some programming rooms, another bathroom, a little bit of storage, and a bit of a lounge area. On the main floor, there's also a lounge area with a fireplace and some couches and chairs. It'll be very nice. It'll be very much like being a home. And that's the idea behind this, is we want people to feel like they've arrived home and they're not out on the street anymore. Behind the house, there's a great big open yard, and we're going to be creating a community garden in that yard. It looks like it will likely be an urban pantry, which is an organization in town of big community gardens around the town that will be sort of managing that garden. But the idea is that those living there will be part of that. They can grow their own vegetables, fresh vegetables, and have access to fresh fruit and vegetables. And then future phase.